Observing Friday prayers in the shadow of the Taliban, Afghanistan's holiest day under its new regime. Flanked by armed fighters, imams were urged to push the message of unity as the Taliban's charm offensive continues while the world is watching.
6 days after their takeover of Kabul, and the Taliban are still preaching forgiveness. Only today, they are using what is, in this country, the most important pulpit of them all to convey welcome that to message.
But it's a message that isn't working for the tens of thousands still trying to leave, making the dangerous journey to the airport.
Genocide might happen. Come to the Kabul airport once, see what is happening. Three children left alone in the ground. Nothing, no one was able to help them. I mean, my heart was crying there.
Tonight, we speak to the families here, fearing for the lives of their loved ones as pressure grows on the government to help them to escape. Also tonight. A big day for the Green Party in Scotland, in government for the first time, sharing power with the SNP. Could another referendum be on the way? And from refugee to revolutionising glassblowing, the man who puts British talent on the map.
I've wanted to give back, you know, wanted to create something as a way of making a contribution.
This is ITV News at 10 with Charlene White.
Good evening. On what is the holiest day of the week in Islam, worshippers in Afghanistan have observed Friday prayers for the first time since the Taliban stormed back to power. And for the first time, its leaders have had an opportunity to spread their charm offensive messages through imams. Imams were told to appeal for unity and to urge citizens not to flee the country. But in direct contrast to that message, in Kabul, armed Taliban could be seen keeping a watchful eye over services, while there have been unconfirmed reports of violence, threats and killings, especially in the more remote regions beyond Kabul. With each disturbing new rumour, the mass panic at Kabul airport becomes more intense, with ever more chaos and desperation.
The first Friday prayers of the new dispensation here. It was worth checking out attendance levels at one of Kabul's biggest mosques. It's likely the turnout this week was bigger than last week, because in between this country became the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan. The ceremony was conducted by a Taliban imam who was flanked by several gunmen. A sight that was intimidating or reassuringly strong, depending on your faith and point of view. It's likely that today the Taliban had the biggest audience since seizing power in Kabul on Sunday. In almost all Afghanistan's 160,000 mosques, the same sermon was preached: forgiveness and equal rights for all communities. 6 days after their takeover of Kabul, and the Taliban are still preaching forgiveness. Only today, they are using what is, in this country, the most important pulpit of them all to convey that message.
The sermon also included an appeal to fellow Afghans to work for the development of the country rather than try to leave it. But at the same time, that's exactly what many Afghans were still trying to do. The road to the airport remains busy and chaotic. In a country that has endured 40 years of civil war, people barely batted an eyelid at the relentless sound of warning shots meant to quell things. Closer to the entrance gate, Western soldiers used flashbangs in a vain attempt to bring some sort of order. At the point where Taliban-controlled Kabul meets the US-controlled Kabul airport, the anguish is palpable. "Help, help," yells a girl. "The Taliban are coming for me." This evening, two American warplanes appeared over the city. A warning to the Taliban not to impede the evacuation. On the ground, an atmosphere of uncertainty lingers.
The shock of Sunday may have subsided, but Kabul has become a twilight zone of competing hopes and fears. Among the people daring to leave home for the first time was Mina, who said she had expected to see the city completely destroyed and was relieved it wasn't. As evacuation planes continue to leave, Taliban fighters continue to arrive. Afghans with no hope of getting out are getting on with things, still on tenterhooks, of course, treading carefully among new rulers, wary of apple carts and upset. John Irvine, News at 10, Kabul.
But for tens of thousands of people, they just want to get out by any means possible, via a desperate scramble for a seat on a flight or the perilous trek to a border crossing. Despite those appeals for calm from Taliban leaders, many of the Afghans now fear for their lives.
This is the sanctuary so many thousands outside the airport perimeter are seeking. US troops on hand to help the weak towards the only exit from Afghanistan. But despite an extra 6,000 American soldiers now deployed at the airport, for many Afghan civilians, getting through the numerous Taliban checkpoints is now impossible. We spoke to one former British Army interpreter trapped in the city who wanted to deliver this withering message to Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab.
You messed up. You need to sort it out. It's all on you. You have to clear a path or send armored vehicles, or send certain personnel to get the civilians out. But do it in a system where they don't have to risk their lives to get through.
This video was taken by a women's rights activist as she tried to get past Taliban gunmen at the airport. She was injured as they opened fire and remained stranded.
Genocide might happen. Come to the Kabul airport once, see what is happening. I was seeing children under my foot. Three children left alone in the ground. No one was able to help them. My heart was crying there.
The small numbers of Afghan interpreters who have now arrived in the UK are concerned about relatives they've left behind. This man is worried about his parents.
The Taliban are searching the compound, the homes, of those people who work with the coalition forces or with the British forces. Yeah, they want to find them and kill them. I'm really sad about my people, about my families, which they're
men who stood by our military with honor now feel utterly betrayed. The offer of safe passage might have been made, but fulfilling that promise is far more challenging. Dan Rivers, News at 10.
All week, we've watched John Irvine and his team report on the chaos in Kabul with immense courage. A little earlier, he was able to give me an update on those trying to escape the Afghan capital.
Charlene, tonight the evacuation process continues to be messy, haphazard and disjointed. To get to the airport, Afghans with or without Western papers for safe passage have to negotiate several Taliban checkpoints. If they're successful, and it's a big if, they then have to reach Western gates manned by soldiers like our paras. Now, those paras are then having to enter the crush to try to filter out those with permission to fly from those who don't have permission to fly. So our soldiers who thought they were coming here just to provide security are being asked to make critical decisions, possibly life and death decisions, about people's fates. The overall political situation is one of limbo. The negotiations still haven't delivered a unity government. The Taliban have promised inclusivity, but presumably they don't want to surrender too much power to ethnicities who in turn don't want to be just fig leaves in any new administration. Overall, Charlene, the situation here in Kabul tonight continues to be confused, messy and worrying, I'm afraid.
John Irvine in Kabul there. Well, in America tonight, President Biden admitted the evacuation is dangerous and comes with a risk of loss to US armed forces. But he reiterated that he stood by his decision on the timing of the US withdrawal from Afghanistan, and he pledged to make every effort to bring home all Americans and Afghans who helped them in the conflict.
Make no mistake, this evacuation mission is dangerous. It involves risks to our armed forces, and it's being conducted under difficult circumstances. I cannot promise what the final outcome will be, or what it will be that it will be without risk of loss. But as Commander-in-Chief, I can assure you that I will mobilize every resource necessary.
Well, as we know, it's not just the Americans under pressure over the evacuation process. Here, the Prime Minister insists he absolutely has full confidence in Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab, despite criticism over his response. Boris Johnson was speaking after chairing an emergency meeting over the situation in Afghanistan. Our political reporter Shihab Khan has joined us in the studio. Shihab, the Prime Minister is really passionately defending Dominic Raab, isn't he?
Yeah, as you say, he says he has absolute full confidence in the Foreign Secretary, who's been under a lot of pressure in the last few days after the reports emerged that while he was on holiday, he was advised by the Foreign Office to call his Afghan counterpart to try and arrange some evacuations, and he delegated that to a junior minister, and ultimately that call didn't happen. Now, the Prime Minister says he doesn't believe it made a massive difference when it comes to the evacuation programme, and he has put his support behind the Foreign Secretary. Does that mean he's safe? We'll have to wait and see. If there are further developments, this story could go on, and we've seen in the past how these things can keep going. Now, another thing the Prime Minister was keen to emphasise was that there is no immediate deadline to Britain's support of Afghan refugees. Have a listen to what he had to say earlier today.
Our plan to help people with the resettlement programme will run for a good while to come. So I think what I'm trying to say to you is it's a mistake to think of the end of this month or the beginning of September as being a cut-off point for our involvement and our willingness to help.
That appears to suggest that there is a long-term plan to help. And sources inside Number 10 were keen tonight to emphasise that is exactly what it is. They are drawing up a number of plans that would suggest that they want to help Afghan refugees for a long period of time. A lot of that is dependent upon what the US does. So we will have to wait and see what their plan is, because ultimately they have a significant amount of influence over what happens in that part of the world.
OK, Shihab, thank you. Well, the events in Afghanistan are also likely to be particularly distressing for veterans from the British Armed Forces who served during the 20 years of conflict. Veterans charities are warning that even watching news of the Taliban's march to power could cause mental traumas that are still raw to flare up. At least 8 of the troops in this photo from the front line, taken in 2006, have been diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder. For the latest in our series of reports based on this poignant snapshot, we spoke to one of those 8.
Ewan Goodman grew up wanting to be a soldier, and he knew early on that he would be going to fight. He'd just started officer training at Sandhurst on September the 11th, 2001.
Having seen the towers come down, one of the generals came in and said, "For you guys, your careers have just changed. This will mean that we will go to war." And he was right.
5 years later, Ewan found himself in one of the most dangerous places on earth. Helmand Province, Afghanistan. A place called Sangin, where the fighting was hard and their training was put to the toughest test.
It's intoxicating and very, very exciting and addictive. So even when you got your 2 weeks away to go back on your R&R, you got home and you were just lost. And it was, why am I even back? Can I just get me back? That's the level of kind of excitement, an addiction that I think, you know, that we all secretly had to it.
Why secretly?
Is that the sort of thing you admit to saying was incredibly addictive and exciting? Warfare? People might think we're a bit odd.
Ewan had volunteered to accompany a battalion of paratroopers working as their translator and unofficial photographer.
Okay, 3, 2, 1.
This was a rare moment of relaxation in a patrol base that was under constant attack, often from Taliban mortar fire.
Yeah, it's quite horrible.
Yeah, describe that for me.
Explosion, big lumps of hot metal exploding from the mortar shell, going up in a cone. So some guys were living in trenches that we'd built. But if you were caught in the open and something fell from the sky, you had no way of protecting yourself from it.
And it's devastating.
Yeah, totally.
After they heard the first explosion.
You can see Ewan here briefing his commanding officer during a break in the fighting. He made it to the end of the tour with no physical injuries, but it wasn't long before his time in Helmand began to take its toll.
Drinking constantly, inability to sleep, recurrent nightmares, feelings of anxiety. Was I depressed, potentially? I had a bag in the boot of my car, which was my grab bag for the people who were following me. I remember psychosis being so vivid as to be looking in the mirror and to be seeing the face of, the reflected face was not mine. And so still, I hate my children having balloons, and I don't go to birthday parties with balloons. I hate Guy Fawkes.
Years on, Ewan has left the military and become a family man. And while he's been treated for post-traumatic stress disorder, there are other ghosts which linger.
I feel very, very sorry for the civilians that were either injured, died, or whose lives have simply been made worse. And they may never understand that we went there looking to try and make things better. We shouldn't have been there, and we haven't learnt a lot from history, and we went into conflicts ill-prepared to deal with the mess that we were going to create. Yeah. So that wasn't worth it.
Ewan loved his time in the military. It made him the man he is, a man who went to war and still lives with its legacy. Geraint Vincent, News at 10.
And you can see more of Ewan's story and all of the coverage on our dedicated website. Just go to itv.com/photo-from-the-front-line. Both the police and MI5 knew the kind of threat posed by the convicted terrorist Sudesh Aman and pleaded for him to be kept behind bars. But he was released according to the terms of his sentence and days later was shot dead by police as he launched a knife attack on the streets of Streatham in South London. Two passers-by were wounded and today an inquest jury said that might have been prevented.
His reign of terror lasted little more than 60 seconds and ended amid panic and police officers who shot him dead. And while the suicide bomb found close to his body was fake, the carnage craved by Sudesh Aman, who swore allegiance to ISIS, was all too real. And yet, the day he planned mass murder, he might instead have been back behind bars. He was already under armed police watch. They were just a few metres away as he came sprinting from a shop with a stolen knife, stabbing two passers-by and spreading terror as officers ran in desperate pursuit, before he turned, knife in hand, to confront the firearms team who shot him dead in self-defence.
The inquest was told that Aman was one of the most dangerous extremists investigated by police and MI5, a troubled young man enthralled by a hate-filled ideology.
He'd served half of a 40-month sentence for terrorist offences. In prison, he'd mixed with Hashem Abedi, jailed for the Manchester Arena bombing, and Ahmed Hassan, who'd tried to blow up a London tube train. But less than 2 weeks before the attack, under rules then in place, he was released early, despite police appeals to extend his sentence. A little more than a week later, he was seen buying materials that could be used to construct a hoax suicide bomb. Senior case officers then met to decide whether to recall him to prison, but the probation service decided he hadn't broken the terms of his license. The jury called that a missed opportunity, though they cleared the police of blame for failing to search a man in the moments before he struck.
Police had real concerns about this attacker, both in relation to his extremist mindset and also what he may do on his release from prison. It is for this reason that we employed and he was monitored by a very professional and a highly skilled team. It's for this reason that they were in the right place at the right time to intervene and stop this becoming a murderous attack.
This ain't real.
It is good fortune that his two victims recovered from their injuries, and little comfort that a man could have inflicted much greater pain. John Ray, News at 10.
It's not a coalition, it's an agreement, but still. The deal which was struck today between the SNP and the Scottish Greens has major implications for the future of the union. The agreement not only puts the Greens in government for the first time in the UK, it also formalises a pro-independence majority in the Scottish Parliament with the potential of another referendum by the end of 2024. We're joined now by our Scotland correspondent, Peter Smith. And Peter, Nicola Sturgeon must be delighted.
Well, certainly, I mean, this is a landmark day for green politics in the UK. The Scottish Greens will have those ministerial positions, but still, somehow, it was Nicola Sturgeon wearing the biggest smile in the room because the timing couldn't be better for her. We're talking about, you know, the climate change agenda is on everyone's mind just now. In 3 months' time, the world's leaders will be coming to Glasgow at the conference centre behind me for the COP26 conference, and now Nicola Sturgeon's green credentials have been boosted. She can carry that kudos with her when she meets Joe Biden and Greta Thunberg here, telling them she has Greens in her government. But ultimately, it's her life's ambition of Scottish independence which is also strengthened. This supporting the majority of parliamentarians in Holyrood who want that second independence referendum. That was the precedent for Scotland having a referendum in 2014, and immediately she sent a warning to Boris Johnson.
This agreement, I think, it's not about making it more likely. I think it makes it harder and indeed impossible on any democratic basis for a UK government to resist the right of the Scottish people to choose their own future.
Now, there's not complete harmony between the Scottish Greens and the SNP. Indeed, there was an awkward moment in the media conference today where Nicola Sturgeon was asked directly, does she support new oil drilling in Scotland at the Campbell oil field just off Shetland? And she can't give a straight yes or no to that. She's saying she's got concerns about it. The Greens have no issue with that. No, so potentially there are some bumps ahead in the road for this partnership, but they are not partnership. This is not a partnership of equals. Nicola Sturgeon is the bigger partner. It's unlikely that those concerns will give her any sleepless nights.
Peter, thank you. When people talk of post-pandemic economic recovery, it often takes a bit of digging to unearth what's really happening. And what emerges from research that we commissioned suggests while some parts of the UK are bouncing back, many others are just not. There are places most threatened by the end of furlough and the scrapping of universal credit uplift in October. The list of hardest hit places includes several outer London boroughs like Brent, where many furloughed cafe and restaurant workers live. Also airport towns like Luton, so dependent on the struggling travel industry. But go to Blackpool, and the contrast of this two-speed recovery couldn't be greater. This summer's surge in staycations has brought a seaside boom.
Alive and illuminated, Blackpool has its sparkle back. As Britain staycates, tourists are coming here on a scale not seen for years. This resort has unfurloughed at pace. One in 14 workers in Blackpool are on the job retention scheme. In the darkest moments of this crisis, it was one in three. Funny Girls is back, along with its cast and crew. This show has survived thanks to hard work, persistence, and a lot of taxpayer support.
She's Las Vegas on heat, Blackpool, at the moment. It's just gone berserk. Upstairs and these seats are all fully booked up to Christmas.
You're fully booked all the way till Christmas?
All to Christmas, yeah.
Blackpool is bouncing back strongly. Luton is not. This town's fortunes are tied to its airport, which is open again, but one in four staff are still furloughed.
We are far from pre-COVID levels. It's good to see people coming through our facilities, but it's still a very low volume.
The aviation industry has warned the government there will be further job losses unless it provides additional financial support. This is supposed to be peak season. On a normal August day, 350 aircraft would come and go at Luton. Today, there are just 168 scheduled. There are fewer flights and fewer passengers on them.
Double S World Choice, Steve speaking.
At Luton's last remaining high street travel agent, bookings are down 98% on pre-COVID levels. The owner says they'd be bust without the job retention scheme, which ends in 6 weeks' time.
How many employees have you got on furlough?
All of them, five.
How many of them can you afford to take back at the end of September?
None, is the honest answer.
You seem...
emotional.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't want to let my staff down.
From Luton to London, which has plenty of tourist attractions, but still very few tourists, and where offices remain unusually quiet. The Joseph Rowntree Foundation says the capital is more exposed to the withdrawal of government support than any other part of the UK. Its main worry is universal credit.
If the Chancellor does go ahead with the £20 a week cut at the beginning of October, we expect 500,000 families to fall into poverty, and that includes 200,000 children.
Brahim Rabi lives in Brent with his four children. He's a single dad who was made redundant just before the first lockdown last March. He's been claiming universal credit ever since and has this message for the Chancellor.
Please, if you put your foot on my shoes, you feel the pain, you feel how much single parents are struggling. A lot of people need that when they quit. It's hard.
The government says it has protected those on the lowest incomes the most during this pandemic, and its priority is helping people back into work. Brahim says he wants to work, but he doesn't know how long it will take until he can stand on his own two feet again. Joel Hills, News at 10.
She's a legend in the lives of both children and adults alike, the author and illustrator Jill Murphy, whose death from cancer at the age of 72 was announced today. Her books featuring The Worst Witch are treasured by young and old alike and made for good TV adaptations too, of course. Her son Charlie said she had a depth of character, a warmth and a life force like no other. Finally, glassblowing is a mysterious and magical art that takes a keen eye, a steady hand and a good pair of lungs. So to still be doing it well into your 80s is unusual enough. But what makes Peter Layton even more remarkable is his life story. The boy who arrived as a refugee from the Nazis is now a subject of an exhibition.
This is ITV News.
The material, the medium, the process, it's entirely magical. It's kind of alchemy, what we do, you know.
Peter Layton has spent a lifetime turning sand into molten glass and shaping that glass into objects of beauty. Drawing inspiration from nature and the things he's seen on his travels.
What's incredibly exciting is to watch people come in and their jaws drop.
Charlene White. This is the ITV Lunchtime News with Alistair Stewart.
A crashing wave frozen in time is one of the latest works of a man who came to Britain as a toddler and refugee when his parents fled former Czechoslovakia to escape the Nazis. He sees a lifetime's work admired around the world.
This is ITV News at 6:30. ITV News with Andrea Byrne.
As a way of making a contribution.
He has certainly done that, not least in recreating the feel of Vincent van Gogh's masterpieces. A challenge laid down by the National Gallery resulted in these works, not painted, but formed from glass.
That sky is a van Gogh sky.
Well, we did hundreds of stormy skies, and they were in all shapes and colours. The sky was the hardest bit.
These days, at 85, he can still be found in his studios in London's Bermondsey, happy to encourage others to keep alive the art of glassblowing. There are no plans to retire.
There's an awful lot more mileage in this. You know, I want to do more exploration.
An exhibition of his life's work is now being staged while Peter Layton explores his next challenge in the magical medium of glass. Paul Davies, News at 10, Bermondsey.
Such beautiful pieces. OK, that's it from us this evening. From me and the whole team, night-night.